So, hello everyone. I'm Alexander Gudovskikh. I'm a professor in the Department of Photonics in this university. Here is just my work in half of time. And another place of work, it's Academic University, now it's Alfeyev University. So, I will present you the course about meteorology of solar cells and some photovoltaic systems. But of course, it will be mainly focused on the task how to measure the characteristics, the parameters of the solar cells. So, first few administrative organization things. We have lectures. Normally, at the beginning, we will have one lecture per day. Also, we have some trainings. So, today we will have the first training. At the end, we'll have some seminars. I will say something, a few words about a little bit later. Some tasks to do to evaluate your level. And one of the main part of our course is a laboratory workshop. So we have three laboratory to be done during our education, and at the end we have examination. So some information for you. And at the first part, we'll focus on the lectures and trainings. Then we'll start laboratory works and seminars. So what about seminars? I mean, I would like to ask you to prepare some short presentation. Really short, it could be even 5 minutes, about some topic concerning meteorology, some characterization, some measurements, I would say. It could be quite a wide range of the measurements, like inline or outline control for production, for test the quality of the materials, structures, maybe some technological operations, some process which is used or could be used in solar cell fabrication. It could be some specific measurement, some technique for characterization of some properties of material solar cells. I mean, there are wide range of the topics. It would be better, mainly for you, if it's if this topic is related to your work. I mean, because you have to prepare some master work. So, if you know already some topic, it would be better. But otherwise, a large range of some activities you can just describe. So the main idea, just to describe the main idea of the methods, how does it work, and mainly how can be used for characterization for solar cells. I mean, what kind of information can you deduce from these measurements? So it's something for the future. So normally I know that I have to repeat this information again at I would say the middle of our course, but just for information to let you know. So here is the outline of my lectures. So we have five main topics which will be discussed described, and the main the first one and third and fourth, but everything is related. Each subject is related to another one. So we'll try to give you some sequence of these topics. And just as a beginning, some reference, some literature to know. I would advise this chapter of the book if you want to get some ideas about some meteorological some specific things. It's very nice source for the information. And so now we will start our course. First, for the introduction, I think everything is what is presented here is well known for you. So you know that the main parameters of the solar cell is IV cube. Hope you know everything, but just repeat because it's something it's the base of our course, because we have to the main idea of our course is to know how to measure correctly IV cube of solar cell, because IV cube is the main parameters of the solar cell. So just one thing, to avoid any mistakes, I'd like to remind that there are two ways to present IV cube. So there is one when you have a positive short circuit current. It's some kind of usual way, some for people, yes, just. But actually, it's not correct from a physical point of view, because from physical point of view, short circuit current is negative. You know that it should be negative, and it cross the axis of voltage at the VOC, the open circuit voltage point, and then goes up. Because if you want to compare the dark IV cube, you know the dark IV cube of any diode, it's like this, and it goes up. But because solar cells, it's some kind of it's like a generator, of it generates the power. Quite often people represent IV cube in this way. So just to don't be confused by this difference. So it's the same thing. So now, as I told, you can find some specific points in the IV cube. So it's this point, as I told, when the current is equal to zero, so IV cube crosses the voltage axis, it's an open circuit voltage point. Another characteristic point is a short circuit current point. So when we have a zero voltage, and the maximum, and the, when the IV cube cross current axis, it's a short circuit current. And from point of view of to produce the power, the point of the maximum power is of main interest. So if you want to deduce the power which could be generated from this solar cell, you have to multiply the current and the voltage. So here the current is equal to zero, so it starts from zero and it goes up and have a maximum at this point, and then it goes down to zero because the voltage, the current is zero here. And this point of the maximum power is actually the point of main interest for solar cell. And our main task is to find this point. And so sometimes you can find some description of this point by voltage of the maximum, of the point of maximum power, and current of the maximum power point. And of course, you can find this. You can say that this point is the point of the maximum power. So I think hope it's clear. And then, actually, you can simply deduce the efficiency of the solar cell, if you know this maximum power and if you know the power of the incident light. First I'd like to present another parameters. I hope you know also, it's a fuel factor. But just to say that it's a way to present the ideality of IV cube. So, what is it? Here is the formalization of this fuel factor. It presents a relation ratio of maximum power point of the maximum power to the product of the VOC and short circuit current. But actually, it means that it's equal to 1 or 100% if our IV cube is really ideal. So it's, you know, it's cannot be achieved, but 90% is actually it's some available, so achievable value, then it depends. So it's if you have a huge difference between the real IV cube, it's not the case. I mean, huge difference. It's IV cube like this, so we can get just to get some ideas about 50-60% of a fuel factor. But sometimes you can get IV cube which is even worse. It's like this. It's so unfortunately it's in reality you can find it sometimes. Of course it means that there is some problem with the solar cell, but of course it gives a quite low value of a fuel factor. So actually it's a very useful thing because normally you can just operate with values like VOC, short circuit current, and fuel factor and efficiency. So actually it's enough to get 3 points, it's a little bit more useful because you don't need each time to see the IV cube. Sometimes it could be useful to have a look to the IV cube if there is some specific points of S shape or some knee or something like this. But if you want to characterize the difference between different solar cells and some slight, if you want to see some dynamics with annealing, etc., it's quite useful to see the evaluation of parameters like VOC, short circuit current, and fuel factor. So, I hope that things I told it's already known for you because you already know about photovoltaics. Just to remind that fuel factor, there are different things to which could get some influence to the fuel factor, but one of the first thing is series resistance. And if you have some increase of the series resistance, first of all, you have a drop of fuel factor. Actually, the shunt resistance also, and we will see in the practice the influence of each parameter. But just to get some idea, because sometimes you can normally you have a influence of short circuit current, so it's some optical losses, like you have some huge reflectance or something, etc. If you see it's a recombination losses, it doesn't mean that only one reason, but mainly. And fuel factor, it's some kind of resistance, shunt resistance, series resistance, and some, it's like electrical losses. And so now, if you know a fuel factor, we can describe the efficiency by this way. So we don't need to find this maximum power. Actually, to define fuel factor, we need it already to find this the maximum power point. But sometimes you just operate with these values. I mean, if you measure IV cube, you have the values of the fuel factor VOC and short circuit current, and then you just need to multiply them to get the efficiency value. And actually, it could be so easy. So you have a measurement, you have these parameters, just one measurement, and easy to find, and just divide by the incident power. So, quite easy. But during the main part of our lectures, I will try to describe why it's not so easy. actually, the main reason, because the incident power, this incident light, it's a solar light. It's a wide range of the energy, and actually it's the main problem of the photovoltaic, because we have to convert the wide range of the energy to the electricity. Because if you have a look to the photoconverters, to the like laser photoconverters, you can find that very huge value of efficiency, up to 70% of efficiency could be achieved for this converter. But the main reason, because they have to convert at the one single wavelength. Here we have a wide range of the wavelength, and concerning the problem of photovoltaics, the wide range of the energy, which is the main problem. And concerning our problem of the measurement, we have to take into account that it's a wide range of the wavelength, it's a wide spectrum. And just to remind that sometimes people use some commercial parameter to characterize the model. It's a ratio between the price of the solar cell, of the module, to the power which is generated. So recently, I mean, from my point of view, it was recently, the target was $1 per watt. Now it's much less, 0.2. So it's really was developed. I mean, the photovoltaic was developed. But I told about, because you know that from a scientific point of view, the main parameter which we want to get is efficiency. And it's really kind of competition between different scientific groups in different countries to get the maximum efficiency. But for production, you have to take in mind also some of the price. And sometimes it have some influence to the scientific activity, because if there is some interest from industry for this type of solar cell, for the cheaper solar cell, there are a lot of activity, of scientific activity for thin film solar cells, for example, then the prices for crystalline silicon dropped, and activity of thin film silicon was a little bit decreased. But again, I'd like to remind that the main parameter we want to get from the measurement is the efficiency. And actually, it's not so easy, because what does it mean, efficiency? For industry, it's rather the power of some module, because if you want to sell some model, some product, you have to describe these properties. So if you want to sell the source of energy, you have to say what is the energy. So it's why normally you can find the power of the module and just in some in data sheet, and not the efficiency. But if you have a look to some reports, some papers from the producers, of course efficiency is one of the main parameters they want to get. But the problem is that the power which is generated by the module, by the solar cell, it depends on many factors. It's like, first of all, it's orientation of the model. Of course, if you change the orientation, you would change this. Of course, the power depends on the intensity, and sometimes even efficiency could depend on intensity. Sometimes it's a good point, sometimes it's an opposite, but it's so to get the real efficiency, sometimes you have to specify the. And one of the most of the main problem that it depends on the solar radiation spectrum, because it's real, especially if you are speaking about multi-junction solar cell. It's the main problem for multi-junction solar cells to get a spectrum. And actually, it depends on the temperature. So, I mean, the efficiency and therefore the production power, it depends on temperature, and therefore the power of model would depend on the temperature of the air, the white speed, so the condition of the cooling. So there are a lot of parameters, a lot of factors which could get some influence to the efficiency of the solar cell. So we need some standard measurement condition. So to make some even test or to make some comparison between different cells obtained by the different groups, different labs, and it's even to get some characterization, because most of the characterization, at least actually it's done even in a laboratory level and in a production level, is done using some artificial light. It's outdoor, indoor, sorry, measurement. Because for outdoor measurement, you see, it's the condition. It's not only always so nice, and sometimes it's really hard to find some less, somewhat some. So, and if you have a look to some data sheet of the real models, you can find some interesting things, that the power which is indicated here, for example, nominal power, it is actually any electrical data presented for standard test condition. It's like here, and for another producer, the same standard test condition. So, what does this standard test condition mean? Actually, to describe it, first of all, I have to describe what is solar light, solar radiation spectrum. So, if you open any book, you would find that the solar radiation spectrum corresponds to the radiation of the black body with a temperature of about 6,000 Kelvin degrees. Then you can find some deviation, because somewhere you can find 5,080 or even more precisely. But actually, if you have a look to the solar spectrum, it's a yellow graph, and the spectrum of the black body is this black cube. So we can find that it depends on how does it fit done. I mean, you can get a little bit better fitting of this cube. But in general, the trend really corresponds to this black body. But this yellow spectrum is a spectrum in the space. It's near to our planet, but it's in the space. When solar light passes through atmosphere, there could be some absorption, scattering, and there could be also some additional reflection from the clouds, from the ground, trees, etc. So, there are different processes, but which affect that spectrum is changing. And here, if you have a look to the solar light, the ground level, which is already passed through atmosphere, you can see that there are a lot of drops, which is related to the, mainly to the absorption in the vapor of water. And you can find the famous ozone layer, actually due to this ozone we have a decrease of the UV light, and spectrum is changed. Of course intensity also changed. So to describe this, actually another thing I would like to mention, that the range is quite wide. It's from UV visible light and infrared part is quite important. So to describe this spectrum, it was decided to get some standard spectrum, and we have actually now three standard spectra, only three. First of all, it's which is called IM0. It's a spectrum in the space spectrum or extraterrestrial. So you can see it's this black cube here with the maximum efficiency. The next one is IM1.5G, so it means global, which represent the whole direct and diffused part of the spectrum. Is it clear what does it mean, diffused part? So we have a direct light, like a laser light, direct, and diffused, it's due to the scattering. So I think today, maybe not this morning, but now it's only a diffused part of the solar light. And so you see, we have some, it's a blue one. Blue, and there is some drops of the spectrum, and there is another one standard spectrum IN1.5D, which means direct, and the angle of 5 degrees. So it's clear it represents only direct part of the light. And you can see that the difference between them, it's not only the intensity, but also in spectra else, there is also a difference in this, in the spectral distribution, because you see for the visible light, there is a huge difference in the intensity. For infrared part, it's not so important, this difference. So there are some differences in the spectrum. And what does it mean, standard spectra? So actually it means that we have some table, some values for the table with a step. Actually the step is a little bit different, it depends on the range. For short wavelength, we have a range of approximately 0.5 nanometer, then above 400 it's 1 nanometer, and then above 2 micron it's 2 nanometer. So some, we can say, tabulated values, but it was, it's a little bit more complicated thing. I mean, how was it decided that it would be some standard spectrum? It's some kind of combination between the measurement and the calculation. So, and of course it specifies a lot of things concerning the measurement condition. So the first I'd like to point it out that the measurement condition are specified, it's angle of increment of receiving surface, so it's 37 degrees. Then the term as a standard atmosphere is used, so which take into account temperature, pressure, so density of some parts, density of air, so there are a lot of layers inside. And another thing which is a little bit more clear, it's absolute air mass of 1.5, it means for the spectrum of 1.5. Actually, it means it gives the name of the spectrum AM, so it means that air mass. So actually, it means that we have a light which goes. It's not direct light like orthogonal to the receiving places. It is in climate with the angle of 48 degrees. Actually, it corresponds some average values of the sun for the countries like European countries, so it was decided that it gives some more or less average information about intensity of the light, and in some literature, sometimes you can find the term AM 1.0, AM 2. So we can calculate this because actually you can calculate how much decrease of the intensity with the angle of the incident light. But actually, it's not some standard value, so it's you can find it. But if you find something AM 1.1 or AM 2, it means that so you can make some calculation. You can try to estimate how was the change of the intensity, but it's have nothing to do with the standard condition. So just want to. Pointed out that if we are speaking about standard condition, so there are only three. One is space for space application, so there is no atmosphere, and there are two for terrestrial application. I'm 1.5 G and D, so nothing else. So also some. Absorption by air and ozone layer was taken into account and scattering, but I mean there are a lot of parameters which was taken into account to calculate the spectrum, and we get this value. So nice, we have this value, we have decided, I would say, the people have decided that we have some standard spectrum. And this standard spectrum should be used to characterize any solar cell. And what I'd like to also remind that any parameters of the modules of the any producer, they are presented for this standard condition. First of all, for this standard spectrum. So, if you have a look again to the spectrum, here I just want to give some information about the spectral distribution. You see there are some parts of the solar light in the UV. So, mainly for the IM0, so in the space, that is actually expected. There are main part of the intensity, but I'd like to point it out that it's intensity, it's in watt, it's not a number of photons, it's not a flux. The maximum is in the visible range of the spectrum, and there are huge part of the spectrum in the infrared. If we just want to have some ideas about semiconductor material which could convert this this light, have selected this area which could be converted by silicon, and if you want to take more light, if you want to convert more photons, for example, here you can use germanium. So just remind that silicon is have a band gap 1.1 or 12 to be a little bit precisely. For germanium, it's 0.66 eV. So just to have some ideas. And the last thing for this picture, so we can see that if we take this spectrum and integrate to get the total incident power, so you can see that for IM0 we have 1,366 watt per square meter. And for 1.5 G, we have a little bit less, actually this correct value, less than 1,000. And for direct light, we have even more less. But just to simplify the calculation, people have decided that okay, there is no reason to use this complicated value, and we will use more nice value, and have decided that the standard condition would be 1 kilowatt per square meter. So it's just to give you an idea that we have some difference between them, but if you have some precise calculation, even for global spectrum, you have some deviation from 1 kilowatt. But for standard condition, it was decided it's not so. It's not a reason to use some values. And actually for direct light, it is the same. Here you can see the standard reference, so reporting or test condition. So there are different ways how to call it, but the Q word is the standard condition. Some in Russia use the standard condition. You can see that for solar cells, for terrestrial application, when we use global, so it means that we have solar cells, flat panels. So the most part of the solar cells, it's flat panels, like silicon flat panels. And here we use 1 kilowatt per square meter. Spectrum, it's IM1.5G. And another thing, I didn't say anything, but it's also important, the temperature should be fixed. It's 25 degrees. It's also an important point that the temperature should be always the same, always 26 degrees. The same for the flat panels, and for concentrating model, for concentrating solar cells, For one sun, we use also 1 kilowatt per square meter. So despite the fact that actually the real value is a little bit less, for 1.5D, we use also 1 kilowatt per square meter. So actually the reason that normally for concentrator solar cell, the intensity changes in quite wide range, up to 1,000 sun or even 10,000 sun. It's some huge values. So in this reason, there is no reason to be too precise for one sun. And is it clear what does it mean, the concentrator solar cell? Yes, it's nice. So. And in contrary, for extraterrestrial, so I mean for space application, where we use the spectrum IM0, the intensity should be 1,366 watt per square meter. So it's some kind of exception. I mean, it's not 1 kilowatt. It's exactly the value, which is, let's say, but again, maybe it was not so clear. The real intensity of the light, it could be changed. I mean, not only during the day due to the clouds, even for extraterrestrial applications, there could be some deviation of the intensity of the spectrum, and for terrestrial application, of course, you have sunrise, sunset, so the spectrum is changing. And it's just some standard condition just to specify the properties of the solar cells. Because when the properties depends on the condition, we have to fix the condition, otherwise we cannot compare them. And so, finally, here it's some kind of conclusion for the standard condition, which is mainly this one. So it's the spectrum is IM1.5G and 1 kilowatt per square meter. Sorry for that. And 25 degrees.